Exit Stage Left: The Curious Afterlife of Pop Stars by Nick Duerden. Read by Matt Bates. The pain I feel from the slit's ending is worse than splitting up with a boyfriend. This feels like the death of a huge part of myself, two whole thirds gone. I've got nowhere to go, nothing to do. I'm cast back into the world like a sycamore seed spinning into the wind. Viv Albertine. Clothes, clothes, clothes. Music, music, music. Boys, boys, boys. I think nostalgia can be a real trap for an artist. When you reminisce about the good old days, you naturally see it all through rose-tinted spectacles. In my case in particular, I think that's forgivable because I probably was wearing rose-tinted spectacles at the time with flashing lights and ostrich feathers attached to them. But if you end up convincing yourself that everything in the past was better than it is now, you might as well give up writing music and retire. Elton John. Me. In the world of rock, nobody ever gives up. Here, retirement is not an option. David Hepworth. A Fabulous Creation. Intro. About 3 weeks into my research for this book, as the world was closing its doors in an attempt to keep a pandemic at bay, I contacted Bill Drummond, arguably the wiliest pop provocateur of his era, and asked if he might like to talk to me on the subject of the curious afterlife of pop stars. What happens, I wanted to know, to those women and men whom we once so idolized, after their moment in the spotlight has been cursorily snuffed out, and they are replaced with barely a pause by the next big thing in an industry that has always fetishized the next big thing above all else? I was fascinated to learn how singers and musicians navigate the rest of their lives after that first flush of fame, how so many of them endure, and also why, occasionally, they don't, how they strive to reinvent themselves, and how they manage to keep life interesting for themselves when they've already had their crowning achievement. Is it really true that the muse can depart as quickly as it arrived? That there are only so many great pop songs any great pop star can churn out, after which, drivel? And is it true, as the American essayist Louis Menand had it in his 1997 New Yorker piece, The Iron Law of Stardom, that stardom cannot last longer than 3 years? Stardom, Menand wrote, is the intersection of personality with history, a perfect congruence of the way the world happens to be and the way the star is. The world, however, moves on. If this is indeed true, somebody might want to inform Ed Sheeran. What's it like to be not just 3 years into your career, but 13 or 33? Pop fans have elephant brains. We like reminders of halcyon days and the soundtracks of our youth. What this means is that while certain people will forever be Duranis, fanatical fans of the 80s group Duran Duran, they will remain far keener to hear Wild Boys, 1984, than, say, something off their disastrous 1995 covers album, Thank You. Or, for that matter, anything the group have released this far into the 21st century, even if the new stuff merits attention. And so, while the pop star may continue to live and breathe and function fairly cognitively, to draw their pensions and write new songs that crave a new audience, many in that audience would much rather they simply remain preserved in aspic, forever 27 and pretty, treading water endlessly. If they are even permitted to still hang around today, it's only because their intermittent reappearances stir within us fond memories. Nostalgia is music's immutable side effect. Best not mess with it. But is there dignity in this? More, is there creative satisfaction? Paul McCartney may be contentedly resigned to forever playing Hey Jude in concert, safe in the knowledge that everything else he's ever done has also been mostly admired and dutifully indulged, but does, say, to Pow's Carol Decker wish fans would stop clamouring for their 1987 number one hit, China in Your Hand, and instead scream for something from their 2015 album, Pleasure and Pain, which reached number 85 in the charts. So many questions. Perhaps too many. I didn't expect Bill Drummond to answer. He is, after all, the elusive type. The kind of man for whom less is more was always better than too much. I particularly wanted to speak to Drummond because he has, in a sense, done it all, but has done so in a way nobody else has or could. If most other bands follow the same yellow brick road, Drummond was busy tearing up the tarmac with a pickaxe while dressed in a great long leather coat. He's been in bands, Liverpool's big in Japan, and once shared a lineup with a pre-Frankie Goes to Hollywood Holly Johnson. He formed the record label Zoo Records with his friend Dave Bolf, the man who later signed Blur. And he has managed bands, Echo and the Bunnymen, The Teardrop Explodes, and produced their albums. He has worked within a major record label, WEA, where he attempted to launch the careers of new acts, including Brilliant and Strawberry Switchblade. And he was a foreboding frontman, but not singer, of the most unusual and unpredictable bands of the late 1980s and early 90s, beginning with the Justified Ancients of Moo Moo, the Time Lords, and the KLF, releasing a string of brilliantly inventive singles like Doctor in the TARDIS, What Time Is Love, 3 AM Eternal, and Last Train to Transcentral. Bangers all. And several of which reach number one across the world. With his KLF co-conspirator Jimmy Corti, he even wrote a book called The Manual, How to Have a Number One the Easy Way. He was a maverick, a Svengali, potentially crazy, and very likely Machiavellian. In that great leather trench coat of his, he looked like a henchman from a Hitchcock movie, and boasted a great slab of ominous face that, in another era, another calling, might just have been immortalized on Mount Rushmore. In 1992, the KLF were awarded Best British Group at the Brit Awards. The acknowledgement failed to flatter them, but did titillate them. They agreed to perform at the ceremony, but only on the condition of doing so with grindcore act Extreme Noise Terror. Part of their performance utilized fake machine guns, which they turned on the first few rows, comprising record industry executives clad in bespoke suits with the requisite cocaine residue about the nostrils, pretending to spray them with bullets in a display of mass execution. During the same show, the British singer-songwriter Beverly Craven played a rendition of her hit Promise Me on the piano, wearing an elegant silk purple blouse and singing with a closed-eyed intensity that prompted fetching crow's feet to sprout at her temples. Craven didn't feel moved to deposit a dead sheep at the entrance of the after-show party, but the KLF did. If Drummond and Corti were trying to convey the contempt with which they viewed the music industry they themselves were a part of, then they did an effective job of it. That same year, they announced their immediate retirement and deleted their entire back catalogue. An act which, from a financial standpoint, was like burning £1 million. A year later, now masquerading as the K Foundation, which celebrated the arts in a manner that required quotation marks around the word celebrated, they set up a £40,000 award, double the amount of the Turner Prize Award, to recognise the worst artist of the year. Its inaugural recipient was Rachel Whiteread, who had also just won the Turner. She was not particularly amused. A year later, the K Foundation then literally burned £1 million in a ceremony on the Scottish island of Jura. The ceremony was quite a to-do. They brought witnesses, the press. They waited until sundown. It was cold. They wore coats. And they filmed it, because of course they did. What else would one expect from art terrorists? There were reasons for the burning of so much money, but the reasons changed depending on who you asked and when you asked, or else you were never particularly clear in the first place, perhaps not even to Drummond and Courtney themselves. The watching world reacted just as they'd hoped, with horror, and the referencing of starving children in Africa. Ever since, Bill Drummond has been circling the sidelines, anything but inactive. He has written more books and continues to dabble in a kind of performance art, though he would no doubt loathe the description. He has shined shoes on the streets of Venice and given away daffodils to strangers in cities around the world. In 2017, he set up a choir. The same year, he and Courtney published a novel, 2023, a trilogy. It was difficult to follow. If it's true that pop stars can struggle with what to do next in order to forge a sufficiently satisfying career after their commercial high point, then Bill Drummond, mischievously, impishly, gloriously, is surely the exception that proves the rule. Anyway, the email. I didn't expect him to engage with me, but in fact he responded with a gratifying swiftness. He thanked me for my invitation, then went on to explain that, as I may or may not know, I did not, he had recently gone through a period of answering all invitations to be interviewed by requesting from the interviewer four questions he had not been asked before in writing. He then answered these four questions in writing, a transaction undertaken only on the understanding that he'd subsequently use the Q&A exchange in a book of his own, a kind of quid pro quo. I was not aware of this book. He did 25 interviews, answering 100 questions in total. The book was called 100 and was published in a run of just 1,000 copies. "They sold," he explained to me, "and that was that." His next interaction with the public was something called the 60-Second Talks Project, a series of video performances in which he talks, in his pleasingly gruff Scottish accent and full of droll enthusiasm, direct to camera on a series of topics. Pish on the red carpet, the birth and death of the zoo, 1978 to 1979, in 1 minute, more or less. There were 60 of these. He was now responding to each new media request, the suggestion being that invariably there were always media requests, by offering up a 40-second play. In other words, if I understood correctly, and it was by no means certain at this point that I did, he was happy to engage with me, but only by his rules, on his terms. I would outline the sort of questions I'd have liked to ask him had we been speaking, and he would respond by writing me a 40-second play. I found myself looking forward to receiving it, and woke each morning reaching for my phone with more purpose than I would normally muster at 7 a.m. The play, however, was not forthcoming. Drummond was busy, distracted. We had recently gone into lockdown, this being the spring of 2020, and he was wrestling with the terrifying concept of homeschooling his young children. I left him to live his life, but several months on, I politely nudged him and, very graciously, one day in early September that year, he went off to his local cafe in North London, perhaps with a laptop, though I prefer to imagine him with a feathered ink pen and a scroll of parchment, to make good on his promise. I could use the play in my book, he said, so long as he could feature our exchange in a book of his own, too. Deal, I said. A minute later, my computer chimed with its arrival. At first, the screen went black, and I feared, for a queasy half moment, that I was subject to a Drummond prank. A K Foundation virus, perhaps. I felt I could almost hear him cackling from his dank, windowless lair. But then the screen quickly came back to life. I unclenched and read. "At times, Bill Drummond is asked to pass comment," the attachment began. "At times, Bill Drummond responds to being asked to pass comment by instigating one of his other selves to write a 40-second play. One of these other selves takes the name of Tenzing Scott Brown. Three of these 40-second plays were written at the corner table of the Café N16. They were written over a period of 3 days in early September 2020. The titles of these three plays are The Glorified Walking Stick, There Is an Afterlife, and The Public Execution of Pop Stars. The first two plays referenced, respectively, the BBC political correspondent Laura Koonsberg and the band he'd once managed, Scottish one-hit wonder Strawberry Switchblade. The third play was, in effect, mine, but then there was an additional one, which had the tantalising title of The Nick Kershaw Minifig. It was included, Drummond wrote, just in case the public execution of pop stars is shite. I reproduce the latter two plays here now with permission. The Public Execution of Pop Stars. The Public Execution of Pop Stars is a 40-second play by Tenzing Scott Brown. The Public Execution of Pop Stars has been written in response to the writer Nick Duerden requesting an interview with Bill Drummond for a proposed book. A book about how singers and musicians navigate their life after the first flush of fame. How they endure, reinvent themselves, and keep life interesting for themselves. This request came in late April 2020, at the height of the first wave of the global pandemic. This request sparked off a brief flurry of emails between Nick Duerden and Bill Drummond. It is now the early autumn of the same year. The second wave is threatening. What follows is the 40-second play written by Tenzing Scott Brown in response to this request. As a play, it has been much informed by the previous 40-second play, There Is an Afterlife. Two women, deep into their middle years, dressed in black and white polka dot dresses and red ribbons in their hair, enter the stage. They are carrying guitars. They face the audience, a worldwide audience, and in unison they recite the following lines. We are Strawberry Switchblade. We exist to confront the world with certain truths. It has been brought to our attention that mankind is the only life form on Earth that is hardwired to destroy each other, and in turn destroy themselves. This hardwiring must be unwired if mankind is to survive. Or, we propose a departure from the tried and tested forms of self-destruction. A departure that will celebrate pop music as the most vibrant and wonderful art form that has ever existed and ever will exist. We propose that any future pop singer or pop group of any past, present, or future genre that has had a top 40 record and then follows it up with a record that fails to make the top 40 will be taken to a designated public space and executed in front of the people. The failed pop singer or pop group will be given the choice of a noose hanging from a gallows or a razor-sharp guillotine. It is this course of action that will truly celebrate pop music as the most vibrant and wonderful art form that has ever existed and ever will exist. Thank you. The end. Strawberry Switchblade then pick up their guitars and start to sing their song Trees and Flowers. And the audience will then compare and contrast the beauty of this song with the power of theatre to impact social change as opposed to merely entertain. This is the second play. The Nick Kershaw Minifig. The Nick Kershaw Minifig is a 40-second play by Tenzing Scott Brown. The Nick Kershaw Minifig has been written as an alternative to the public execution of pop stars, as in case the public execution of pop stars is shite. The Nick Kershaw Minifig has only one character, a Lego minifig of former pop star Nick Kershaw. He addresses the audience directly. Tenzing Scott Brown invited Prince to write a foreword to this 40-second play. What follows is the foreword. Hi, My name is Prince. I used to be a famous pop star in the 1980s. What made me famous was that I was a genius. It's what got me noticed. But then I started doing stuff that made me look mad. I started to stop using my name and used a squiggle instead, and making records to annoy my record company, records that were indulgent. And although I was a genius, people stopped buying my records. So I changed my name back to Prince and did a world tour where I was a caricature of how I used to look in my purple patch in 1984. But this world tour was in 2007. It was as if the Beatles had reformed in 1987 and they went out touring as middle-aged men but wearing their collarless Beatles suits they wore in 1964. It was pathetic. But it is what the fans wanted. They loved me for it. So I took too many painkillers and died. I'm afraid I do not know who Nick Kershaw or Minifigs are. That was the foreword by Prince. This is the 40-second play called The Nick Kershaw Minifig. Hi, my name is Nick Kershaw. I used to be a famous pop star in the 1980s. What made me famous was that I could write good pop songs and I was cute. But then people stopped buying my records, even though I could still write good pop songs and I was still cute. It is now 30-something years later, and I still make records. But all my fans want to hear is my old hits from the 1980s. So I have decided to become a Lego minifig of myself. And using a stop-motion app I have on my phone, remake all my old videos from the 1980s using Lego. I think it is what all pop stars from the 80s should do. Fans will love it. And it keeps you busy. And you never grow old. If Prince were alive today, it is what he should be doing. It is either that or the gardening. I've got my own YouTube channel and everything. The end. This was the end of our communication. I read these plays twice, and then a third time, always with a certain glee. What Bill Drummond is getting at here, I think, is just how thankless a task it can be for the pop star, whether an unusually gifted one or a rather run-of-the-mill example, who dares to try to endure beyond their Warholian 15 minutes. By rights, they're supposed to be a flash in the pan, a pin-up who disappears before we have the chance to get bored of them, thus leaving in their wake slippery moments of throwaway bliss. Do we really want our favourite acts today to endure for 1,000 tomorrows? To go on long after their commercial peak and release more albums still? Personal albums, experimental ones, perhaps even concept albums, compelling us to bear witness as they continue to stretch themselves long after their creativity has waned. Don't those who do hang around have the good sense to simply stick to what people really want, a regurgitation of the old hits and nothing but until the end of their time? The fact that so many of them do not possess this notional good sense is why Bill Drummond, for one, wants to guillotine them. To stop, say, Rod Stewart from endlessly covering the Great American Songbook, to prevent Oasis making their Cocaine record, and to block Paul McCartney from recording with frog choruses. Pop music is supposed to be fleeting. Likewise, its players. It's good while it lasts, yes, but it's also yesterday's newspapers, to be replaced by today's edition. There is a certain thrill held for the band that lives fast and dies young, a thrill even to the one-hit wonder, to the act that manages to create something perfect, which goes out into the world and resonates wildly, and which is not then diminished and sullied when that same act later announces to the watching world, "And now for my operatic concept album on the ravages of global warming, played mostly on the mandolin. Please bear with me." Bill Drummond feels this way because this is precisely what Drummond did with the KLF. He pulled the plug while everybody was still wanting more. But then this is deeply anomalous behaviour. We cannot reasonably expect the artists behind our favourite songs, clever, artistic people with much to offer, to suddenly politely disappear just in case we grow tired of them over time. Can we? In 1993, Billy Joel released his last album, River of Dreams, and aside from one further album of classical piano pieces, has felt no compulsion to write anything else. He still enjoys playing the hits catalogue live. He's sold hundreds of millions of records, and he's proved his worth. What else is there to say? I know some artists struggle with the idea of being relevant, but I stopped buying that a long time ago, Joel told Billboard magazine in 2019. This hints at someone entirely at peace with their identity, and as such marks Joel out as unusual. Most artists view things a little differently. They may have had their time in the sun, their three ironclad years, and they may have been forcefully shuffled to the margins by tastemakers wielding figurative brooms, but they don't really go away. They don't disappear and stop doing what they've always done. Of course they don't. They're artists. That breed of humans who are never cut out for the traditional 9-to-5, for the daily commute, for cookie-cutter conventionality. So even after they've reluctantly parted ways with the zeitgeist, the songs keep coming. They keep plugging away. This might actually be when their true metal is revealed, when they can, and often do, come to seem genuinely inspirational. They've survived the sonic boom of youth and its attendant creative spurt, but they've ever since refocused and realigned their ambition and expectation. Still, they stride on. And we, the fans, keep listening. In the age of streaming, it's never been cheaper or easier to do so. Bands and artists that have long since fallen off the radar continue to attract hundreds of thousands, often millions of streams a month. Global pandemics permitting, they play live regularly. And they continue to make new music all the bloody time. The breakup album, the going back to my roots album, and if occasionally new music does run dry, no matter, because for heritage acts, the well is bottomless. There is always a new greatest hits selection to curate, a back catalogue to reimagine acoustically, or with orchestral accompaniment, or perhaps with added dance beats. The 10th anniversary of a number one hit single, the 20th anniversary of that seminal album, celebrations for which will see them comfortably back on the arena circuit again, fortunes revived. Ostensibly, pop music exists within an industry obsessed with the idea of novelty. There is little more viscerally asphyxiating or marketable than an act that emerges seemingly out of nowhere as an instantaneous approximation of perfection. This prompts record companies to try and replicate that ungraspable magic with another singer, another band, whom they hope will follow in the trailblazers' wake, just as another singer and another band waits impatiently in the wings behind them, and so on, like aeroplanes looming into Heathrow, one after the other, an endless line of blinking lights on the horizon. First there was Elvis Presley, who did things with his hips and lips and hair, at the same time, and who seemed to have about him more heat than dynamite, and who could, as Bob Dylan had it, take songs to other planets. There was U2, who, if they didn't quite invent stadium rock, nevertheless made it their own, and without whom the stadium rock industry of the 21st century wouldn't look the way it now does. And there was Adele, who could so capably articulate the bruises our hearts take in love that the power ballad is now the lingua franca of all truly effective pop. And behind them, so many wannabe Elvises, so many half-powered U2s, so many anemic Adeles. Thank you. Next. The best thing the Beatles ever did, in a career filled with best things, was to split in 1970. This way, they never tainted their canon, nor diluted it, but rather allowed time to ripen its individual notes like fine wine. ABBA did likewise a decade or so later, before a full 40 years later, they would inconveniently disprove this theory by releasing new music that sounded just like their old music, and seduced everyone all over again. There is only one ABBA. Janis Joplin, too much of a firework to be contained by the 1972 folk scene, died at the age of 27. So did Jimi Hendrix, Jim Morrison, Kurt Cobain, Amy Winehouse. Each gone before their time, with so much potential still to realise. But because they never got to scale their peaks, they never had to descend either. They bailed out on top. As for all the others, they survived. They're still here. To be reckless enough to try and carve out an enduring career in pop, then, is not for the faint-hearted. By their very definition, pop stars tend to be exceptional people, not just gifted and talented, but preternaturally driven to be heard, to matter, to enthrall. They are indulged and cosseted, cocooned from normality and inflated in ego. They lose their sense of perspective and wear sunglasses indoors. Some of them are not nice people, not nice at all, but we remain mostly enthralled to them. Their experiences mark them out, and they are defined by them, sometimes ruinously. In the many written accounts of what happened to the 13 men who have walked on the surface of the moon, the same two questions are repeated over and over ad infinitum. 1. What was it like? And 2. What did he do next? Many of the 13 were reported to have later succumbed to depression, others to alcoholism. Each were branded in some way by their achievement, by having blazed so brightly and left such a lingering, if steadily evaporating, trail. A group of people whose peak moment in life was already consigned to the past. Achieving pop glory is, of course, in no way comparable to setting foot on the moon. It was always far easier in decades past for a bunch of hopefuls masquerading under some fanciful name to appear on Top of the Pops than it was to walk in zero gravity. But pop stardom and astronaut have always featured highly on people's dream ambition lists, and those who manage it remain literally extraordinary. And so relegation to Civvy Street isn't always easy, and the journey a former punk icon, say, is forced to take from having terrified the nation's youth to endorsing a particular brand of butter is long and winding and full of pathos. Or consider the tall bassist from one of the 90s most strident bands who found himself driving a van for a living not 6 months after their final farewell tour. When the offer of a reunion came a few years later, the tall bassist didn't have to consider his answer for long. Life is a complicated business for all of us, and perhaps more so for those who still believe they are not entirely suited for the humdrum. It's not everyone who has the ability to walk out on a stage in front of thousands, possessed of the conviction that they command it. Those who do are never going to exit that stage entirely willingly, and nor do we tend to let them either. So they carry on, fighting. In the minds of their followers, at least, the good fight. They get older and heavier and more careful about their diet and the drugs they take. Their hair thins out. They become veterans of AA and NA. Some grow disillusioned and cynical. Others feel nothing but gratitude that they still get to do the thing they love most and still have an audience, irrespective of size, that appreciates their efforts. Correspondingly, their music becomes more demonstrably expressive and more truthful, more capable of touching the heart. Why do we remain so inexorably drawn to them, still fascinated by those whose posters we once so lovingly hung on our bedroom walls? What makes us so enduringly compelled by those who choose to sing songs for a living? And why do so many artists continue to do it? Keep on putting down words that rhyme and writing appropriately catchy melodies over and over again. What's it like to be still at it at 45, at 60? And how does it compare to the sensations it conjured 2 decades previously? Is it easy to redefine your goals, to come back down the mountain? And ultimately, why is it so hard to walk away from it all? Chapter 1. Marmalade Skies and Kaleidoscope Eyes. 1. I don't think I deserve anything because I rejected my art, the very worst thing an artist can do. At the beginning, all was good and everything was swollen with promise. The Only Ones, a cantankerous punk act from London that had formed in 1976 and then giggled relentlessly with the gritty purpose all half-decent punk acts had back then, were ready at last to announce themselves to the world. It was 1978. By this stage, the Sex Pistols had happened, so too had The Clash, The Buzzcocks and Generation X, and so, the band figured, the ground was fertile and ready for them. Their single, Another Girl, Another Planet, was a freewheeling racket sung in the reediest of voices, but packed with a snarling swagger typical of the time. It didn't break the top 40, though great records rarely did back in the late 1970s. It didn't even make the top 50, but this was fine. It allowed the music press to hail them as a great overlooked force whose day would soon come like a reckoning. The music press was wrong, as it turned out. The song itself would indeed be later hailed as a classic, but the band never lived up to its promise. Instead, all that potential ultimately dashed against the rocks of their instinctive self-destruction. In other words, drugs. By 1980, they still felt reasonably confident of a late breakthrough. Punk had died by then, but the Only Ones were now better than ever. That year, they were in America, supporting The Who, playing huge arenas. But they were nervous. They needed fortification. Peter Perrette, the singer, had always been prone to hedonism, but only, he points out, in my relaxation time, I tended to keep it, the drugs, to my downtime. So when we were working, when I was on tour, I wouldn't take drugs with me. Of course, if they happened to appear, then okay, that wasn't my doing, that was fate. But I did try to keep them separate because that's the way I felt I'd do my best work. But then towards the end of the tour, they became a larger part and they started to appear more often than not. I suppose I was already going in that direction, he concedes, but I hadn't yet surrendered to that way of life. He would in time. But right now, halfway through 1980, somewhere in California, Perrette, a sallow youth from Camberwell, South London, was enjoying the sunshine. He was 4 years into his career and had come to realise that, while patience was a virtue, it wasn't always something he had ready access to. The band had released 3 albums, each to good reviews, but there was a creeping sense that their time had passed, that punk was already as old as the 3-day week, and that the new decade was looking for something else. He focused for the time being on what was in front of him. Big shows each night supporting a stadium rock act, good money, plenty of downtime, plenty of drugs. He couldn't want for anything else. When your life has suddenly taken off and all your dreams come true, you want to explore those dreams, don't you? It's very tempting to do just that, to explore the entire universe. This wasn't really work, it's something you enjoy. And I think, maybe for me, I enjoyed being able to detach myself. I enjoyed the calmness and the escape from all responsibility. A lot of songwriters are sensitive human beings, aren't they? Perhaps that's where their passion comes from. But it is tempting sometimes to retreat from that. By obliterating himself each night, lying back, his eyes rolling to a point high above his eyelids, Perrette retreated. When the tour reached California, however, there was an altercation that would conspire to colour the rest of his life. Parking his hire car outside that night's venue, he got into an argument with a man who wanted him to park elsewhere. When Perrette declined, the man became angry and started to strangle him. Perrette would later explain that he was used to having big people around to protect him, the Who's security guards mostly, but right now, here, he was alone and defenseless, and far too slight to fight back. Punks were always skin and bone. He could feel his windpipe being crushed. "The only weapon I had," he later explained in Mojo magazine, "was the car." Managing to get free of the man's grip, he ran to the car, jumped in, started the engine and drove, not to an appropriate parking place, but rather directly at his attacker. He had a smile on his face, and in slow motion it changed to a look of total horror. "The last I saw of him, he disappeared over some bins," Perrette told Mojo. "Then I drove off and felt really great. And then it dawned on me what I'd done." In the state of California, it isn't legal to run over someone with a car, even if provoked into doing so. It also isn't legal to flee the scene. Perrette, already paranoid from all the drugs he was ingesting daily, convinced himself, in those moments of clarity that panic sometimes allows, that he not only couldn't possibly hand himself into the police, but that he had to get out of the country fast. What happened next happened quickly. The only one's part on the Who's US tour was cut short. The headliners were unimpressed, as were Perrette's own band. A few days later, they were back on the East Coast, awaiting the flight home. "Alan," Mayer, bassist, "came to see me in our hotel in New York," Perrette says. "Not happy. A lot of things had gone wrong. We'd had to cancel the last 30 gigs to get out of the country because of the trouble I'd got into, and he said that he wanted to leave. I got a sick feeling in my stomach. You know, when you're 13 and your girlfriend chucks you, it felt like that. But instead of saying to him, 'Let's talk about it,' I left. I quit. I regret that, I do. Ever since, I've kept thinking about what might have been." This may have been a sad development, but hardly an untypical one. Bands are not structured to remain harmonious. There is too much imbalance, too much stress, too much to fall out over. Nothing in Perrette's life had fully prepared him for this. Only experience teaches you, by which time it's too late. Singing had been his childhood ambition, and the ambition was realized, but then it was abruptly snuffed out. He was 32 years old. Peter Perrette had been born into a working-class family in London, and until the age of 11, had briefly considered a career in football, because boys do. But he came to realize that it was music, not sport, that consumed his every thought. "I got a guitar when I was 17 and learned how to play most things with the same three chords, and then how to fit those chords around tunes, and then I started writing my songs." He'd no idea what to do with these songs once they were finished. How was he supposed to get them out into the world, into the shops and on the radio? By the mid-70s, still young, he was already in a relationship with the woman who would go on to become his wife, Zena. And it was Zena who encouraged him, insisting he should pursue it to the exclusion of everything else. Once he'd written an album's worth of songs, she told him, he should take them to record companies, whose addresses were in the phone book. That was how it was done. "But I always thought that was beneath me," he says, proving in just 8 words that artists really aren't the best people to operate the heavy machinery of adulthood. "I didn't want to be judged by lesser mortals." His genius, he suggests, wasn't recognized until he met some like-minded souls. John Perry, Mike Kelly and Alan Mayer, the people with whom he would form the Only Ones. Here were people he could hide behind, who could bolster his confidence. Things started well enough, but Perrette soon started feeling the pressures of his role. The more he felt he couldn't cope with it, the more he couldn't cope. His feelings of panic a self-fulfilling prophecy. After America, he thought it best to hibernate. His house in South London had a front door that was positioned at the top of several steep steps, a design, he would later say, that made it all but impossible for police to ram it open whenever they arrived with search warrants looking for drugs. At first, Peretz was a mere user, smack, crack, but drugs cost money, and so, to fund his habit, he started to deal. It was like a fortress, our place. I felt very safe in my fortress. Here, he was removed from the complications of the world and his place in it, and life was reduced to its basic fundamentals. Get high, come down, get high again, with occasional breaks for food, water, the toilet. You don't really live in the real world when you're a dealer, do you? He says. It's a black market economy, and if you've got the right contacts, if you can get something at the right price, then you can, well, you can imagine how the black market economy works, can't you? Once he was peddling songs, now it was drugs. Both can lift the spirits. The only time I wasn't surviving was when I got clean and started to do music again in the early 90s, I think. If the 80s was mostly a lost decade, then by the 90s he'd decided to live again. To live meant a return to music. And penury. I'd be in the studio, which isn't cheap, and Zena would be asking me to see if there was any coffee or sugar I could bring back. That was hard. Despite the chaos of their lives, they did manage to eke out a kind of normality. They had children, two boys. Perrette laughs. I think you better talk to them, his children, to ask how normal they felt their life was. As they got older, they got better at looking after us, put it that way. But I think there were many times they wanted to put us up for adoption. Their sons would grow up to be in bands themselves, one in an iteration of Baby Shambles, the act formed by Pete Doherty after the Libertines founded for much the same reason the Only Ones had three decades previously. Both, now in their late 30s and early 40s, have played in their father's live band. If Perrette's tale is a horribly familiar one to anyone who may have battled with addiction, it's familiar in another way too. Once in a band, always in a band. Music never really gives up its possession of those it afflicts, and so artists invariably find themselves returning to it, so long as they are sentient enough to pursue it. But for the longest time, Perrette wasn't. Didn't pick up a guitar, didn't listen to music, not for years. I couldn't stop words coming into my head, lyrics and that, but I never wrote things down. I always thought that if things were worth remembering, I'd remember them. It's only as I got older that I realised I wasn't actually remembering the good stuff I'd come up with at all. It had all gone. When we speak, Perrette is 68. I'm working hard just to maintain a sort of old man health these days. He is clean at last. He tried many times to stop drugs over the years and occasionally managed, but never for very long. He first went to rehab in 1985, and his reaction to going cold turkey was to suddenly rediscover his appetite for music. If I was clean, I could write songs. It wasn't a conscious thing, it just happened, I suppose, because if I'm clean, then not every minute of my time is taken up with consuming drugs. I had to find other things to do with my hands. The plan was always to get clean and stay clean, and then to do music again, but, as you know, junkies have a habit of always putting things off. I'll get clean next week. I'll leave London. Go to rehab, get clean and start again. I'll do it next week, next month, soon. A decade later, he found he had enough songs for an album, his first as a solo artist. But the sudden pressure he felt prompted a binge, which, he suggests, lasted all the way until 2008. That was my worst period, definitely. In the midst of his most enduring binge, The 12 most devastating years of his life, when he did nothing except take drugs and watch time pass. That single from 1978, Another Girl, Another Planet, was living its own life, growing steadily in stature and becoming regarded in some quarters as a classic. Contemporary bands began covering it. R.E.M., Billy Bragg, The Cure, the American pop-punk act Blink-182. Word of its buoyant afterlife would occasionally reach its author in his cave, and then, after he was taught how to use YouTube, he'd search for video evidence. It touched him deeply. It reminded people that we'd existed, and I suppose it opened the door for people to discover more of our music. I've always been incredibly grateful for that. It offered him a lifeline, and a crucially useful source of additional income too, even if he'd ultimately squander it on more drugs. But if he squinted hard enough, and sometimes he did try, he could see light at the end of the tunnel. In 2007, Vodafone used the song for a TV ad campaign. Probably made $100,000 from that. Around the same time, he sold his house in the hope that a change of postcode would encourage him to stop dealing. If he stopped dealing, maybe he and his wife could stop using. His neighborhood was then becoming gentrified, and so what was once inescapably unappealing, the self-professed fortress and drug den whose chief occupants were not always as house-proud as they might otherwise have been, and whose carpets needed changing, was suddenly viewed as a doer-upper and worth a mint. He made about £500,000 profit from its sale, which, when combined with his Vodafone fee, made him properly flush for the first time in his life. Music had given him this, and he was duly humbled. Was this, perhaps, a second chance? No, not quite. If we were sensible people, we'd have planned for the future, used it to buy a really nice house with something like that. But instead, we just kept taking drugs until the money ran out. It takes quite a long time to smoke £600,000 worth of drugs. By the time he was penniless once more, his health was poor, and so was his wife's. We were severely damaged by then, not just physically, but mentally. Perrette talks about the ravages of long-term drug use by slipping into imagery. It's like being adrift at sea without a compass, he says. You're forever at the mercy of the winds, being pushed whichever way. No, wait, it's more like you're hurtling through space in a spaceship, controlled by the ship's computer, but the computer has a virus. Eventually you find yourself crash-landing back to Earth. It was when I crash-landed that I had my burst of creativity. But while I was up there, in space, at sea, wherever, everything just didn't exist. He blames his career choice for his narcotic tendencies. He might have felt less need to do vast quantities of drugs had he been, say, a plumber, for the simple reason that there is less performance anxiety in changing a toilet's U-bend than there is standing on stage in front of thousands. Music may have been a compulsion, but it was a nightmare for his anxiety. After the Vodafone ad, interest in The Only Ones perked up. People learned of their story, and folk do love a cautionary tale. Perrette, who had no management and little to no contact with anyone in the industry, was duly tracked down. His phone started ringing. Occasionally, he felt moved to answer it. His fellow band members got in touch. They too were thrilled by the exposure and wanted to reform because there was money to be made. Good money. Trouble was, the singer was still an addict. All he really wanted to do was stay at home and take drugs. That same year, 2007, Warren Ellis, the bassist in Nick Cave and the Bad Seeds, was curating All Tomorrow's Parties, a music festival that took place in Butlin's Minehead in December. Ellis reached out, explaining he'd been a big fan. Could they come and play? Three quarters of the band said yes immediately, but their confirmation was contingent upon the lead singer. Would his skinny trousers still fit? They turned up at my door, perhaps the first time I'd seen them together properly in, what, 27 years? So that was quite an emotional thing. I knew these people. I knew that I used to do good stuff with them. They wanted to get back together, and I suppose because I was the least disposable member, I had to say yes. But Perrette was nothing if not consistent. The moment he agreed, his stomach turned to liquid, and he reached for his stash. But I still said yes to the reunion, and so, all of a sudden, we were back on. It's not easy to marshal an addict into doing what needs to be done when they'd much rather be doing something else entirely. Perrette was 55 years old then, and hadn't played live in over a quarter of a century. The more the date loomed in his diary, and of course the diary never existed, it's a metaphorical diary, the more he quaked. "I didn't let myself think about it," he says. Minehead is a two-hour journey by car from London. In the weeks running up to the event, the band had managed to get together for a couple of rehearsals, and these had gone well enough, surprisingly so, to prompt them to attempt a small gig in front of an audience, supporting the band Perrette's sons were in at the time, Love Minus Zero. The show went well. The assembled crowd clapped and cheered, and the occasion allowed Perrette to remember who he'd once been so very long ago. At Butlin's, hardly Altamont or Red Rocks or Madison Square Garden, but exciting enough, they were to open the festival. Stage time was 7 p.m. The band could have driven down on the day, but didn't want to take any chances, and so had made the journey the night before. This meant that any delays, any unforeseen issues, could be dealt with in sufficient time. Perrette was prepared. "I thought I'd brought enough. You know, you always have enough smack with you because there's only so much smack you can do, so that was okay." His plan? To do just enough to get him into the right headspace, which would facilitate the only ones with their reincarnation. "I also thought I'd brought enough crack for the whole weekend, but then when we got there the night before the show, I stayed up all night. And when you stay up all night, you find you can do so much more than you thought you were capable of. So there I was in my chalet at the campsite, 4 o'clock in the morning, all good. But then at 5, I'd run out of crack and so immediately fell asleep." What happened next, the way he tells it, is a little confusing, but it requires effort to climb out of a drug stupor, and Perrette was out for the count. He slept through breakfast, through lunch. He missed the sound check. Their stage time rapidly approaching, the band went to look for him and found him still in his bed. They tried to rouse him, raising voices, slapping cheeks. "They were trying to hit me, shake me, but I was out cold." He laughs at the second-hand memory. "Eventually, my son found someone who had some powdered coke, so they blew the powdered coke up my nose, and it worked. I woke up." By now, they should have been on stage already. They got him dressed, then led him forcibly to the venue. They made it on stage by 7:15 p.m. "Only 15 minutes late. Result." For one glorious stolen night, the only ones were back. All their romantic ideas of recapturing some of that initial spirit and injecting it with something newly fresh and alive conjured up right there on stage in real time. The audience was appreciative, Warren Ellis admiring, relieved. A subsequent UK tour was hastily arranged off the back of it, and Perrette, importantly, seemed to be up for it. Being in front of an audience again had affected him profoundly. "Some of them," at Butlin's, "had tears streaming down their faces. They weren't reacting to the performance," he adds, "or the state of my voice, which is not what it was, but more because it was a celebration of what we'd done in the past, what we'd achieved, that immortality that musicians are so fortunate to have. Music is such an emotional release, isn't it? I mean, all art forms have pleasure, and I know I'm biased, but the buzz music gives you, you can't live without it, really, can you?" It made him wonder what life might have been like had he not become an addict. Drugs had been responsible for his undoing, for suffocating his creativity and curdling his potential. He was adamant this time. When he and his wife tried to quit properly again in 2011, Perrette was placed on methadone, which he stayed on for the next 4 years. After which? Cured. Junkie no more. "You have all the normal mental health issues of every other junkie, of course," he points out. "And I know how many people get depressed about it, a whole life wasted, things like that. But luckily, me and Zena, we got extreme gallows humour, so we've been able to laugh about it. We amuse each other that way. But the physical aspects, to be honest with you, they're not retrievable. We smoked our drugs, so our lungs are shot, severely damaged." Back in the early days, Perrette never really exerted much in the way of effort. What did come to him in terms of talent and focus came to him naturally. He never had the discipline of an athlete. Now he's old, he's more mindful. "These days I work really hard at just being barely functional because that's all I can manage. My lung consultant's amazed I can even sing at all." He thinks about all he's come through. "When you stop taking drugs 24 hours a day, every day, you don't go cold turkey immediately. With crack, you don't get a physical withdrawal. If you stop smoking crack, you just sleep, which your body needs after not sleeping for such a long time. With heroin, you need something else, because otherwise you do get the physical withdrawals, so that's why I started on the methadone." He did go back on heroin once, a one-off, he insists, at the end of 2009, maybe 2010. But by 2011, he'd stopped smoking everything, including joints, which he'd been puffing on up to 30 times a day. And after that, he quit nicotine. Sobriety, he says, allowed the songs back in. "Music's something that's inside you. It takes you to a special place like nothing else. Nothing's better than writing a song, rehearsing it with your band, and it being everything you imagined in your head. The melody, the lyrics, the musical landscape it exists within. When that does happen, you get such a buzz from it. It's like nothing else." Not even drugs? Not even drugs. And so, for Perrette, a return to clarity meant a return to creativity. He'd stopped dealing, thankful that it had never led to a conviction or prison, and his band continued to tour. But magic is rarely rekindled for long. The only ones split up again, for all sorts of complicated reasons, but Perrette was determined to continue. "You know, in some ways I don't think I deserve anything anymore because I rejected my art. That's the very worst thing an artist can do." He counted his blessings. A strong early start, an enduring single, and fans that wanted more. In 2017, he released a solo album, How the West Was Won, and followed it up 2 years later with another, Human World. If, as we shall hear in future chapters, the public seemed to have an aversion to musicians in their middle years, midlife being such a difficult period to navigate, then those that make it to the other side, and to a certain age, are treated quite differently. They're welcomed back with open arms, reappraised and lauded for their longevity. Perrette's pensionable comeback was a resounding success. The reviews were kind, the accompanying tours went well, and he was busy fostering his new addiction. Songwriting. "For me, there's no artistic pleasure to be found in playing old songs, so I knew I'd always need to do new ones. I mean, I know that I'm nowhere near as good as I used to be and that I'm still stuck with my voice as it is today. I'm always going to sound like me, but I still like to push myself. And I'm enjoying it, I really am. And that, well, that's priceless." Over the last few years, he's become increasingly aware that his memory is unravelling. a ribbon flung to dark corners he can no longer quite see. I don't think I've got Alzheimer's or anything, but the extreme lucidity's gone. I'm working within parameters now. The titles of the new songs he's working on, Do Not Resuscitate, I Want to Go with Dignity, suggest that his gallows humour, too, has remained intact. The physical and mental deterioration are the only real downsides these days, I think. But there is wisdom now, and a more measured outlook on this whole meaningless thing we call life. That's a plus. And the closer I approach mortality, the harder I find it not to face it. I'm a songwriter, so I write about it. 2. I wasn't just going to throw it all away. With Sean Ryder, it's difficult to know where to even begin. If ever there was a physical manifestation of the live fast, die young school of rockstar cliché, then surely it was to be found somewhere within the voluminous flapping flares of the Happy Mondays frontman, a walking caricature of dodgy geezer writ so large that he practically came with his own sitcom laughter soundtrack. If Peter Perrette liked to do drugs in the privacy of his own home and found that they stifled his creativity and killed his passion, then for Ryder, they were linked so closely to the creative process that one simply couldn't have existed without the other. The cliché never wore thin, however, because Ryder has gone on to do something quietly remarkable with his career. For starters, he didn't die. At the time of writing, he remains a propulsive member of the gloriously undead. And though he may be somewhere close to the tail end of his 9 cats' lives, he has either shrewdly reinvented himself or unwittingly found himself unexpectedly reinvented multiple times to the point where, by now, the man is practically a national treasure. He's been in bands, indulged in some unusual collaborations, fronted television programs, written books, expounded on haunted houses in documentaries, done reality TV, and has even advertised nicotine patches on his Twitter page. Proper zingy. Never above product placement if it pays him a living wage. At 62, in competent command of most, if not quite all, his faculties, he still makes music too.
Still got things to say, innit? He says.
No one could ever accuse him of being an inspiration, because Ryder's blueprint for how to carve out an enduring career in music is illegible to every single soul except himself. But his constant blinking wonder at the world around him, like a goldfish performing its circuit and seeing everything with new eyes as it comes around again, is somehow a marvellous thing to bear witness to. He grins more easily than most. While Keith Richards is falling out of coconut trees onto his head and Shane McGowan is increasingly cantankerous and lost, Sean Ryder, the erstwhile dodgy geezer, is someone whose addled charisma could light up Regent Street at Christmas. The son of a postman and a nurse, he grew up in Moss Side, Manchester, did not do well at school, and fancied he might deal drugs in adulthood, because dealing drugs meant cash transactions that would keep him in nice clobber, good drink and gear. He formed Happy Mondays in 1985, describing the 5-man lineup, which featured his brother Paul and his best mate Bez, as a bunch of scroats. They signed to Manchester's Factory label, surely the only record company willing to take the risk. At first, Ryder was going to play the drums, taken with the idea of hitting things, but he had little rhythm. He was no singer either, his voice like a hyena coughing up a furball, but his way with words was erratic, nonsensical, streams of consciousness, and entirely compelling. Poetry by any other name. The band sounded like nobody else, an accusation you could level at precious few acts at any time in history. Their musical ability back then was small print they didn't bother to read, but they could make a noise, and it sounded great to their ears.
If you're shit, you're shit, he says, and you get found out pretty quick, but we were learning, and we were getting better.
There has arguably never been a more work-in-progress debut album than the Monday's 1987 effort, Squirrel and G-Man 24-Hour Party People, Plastic Face Can't Smile, Whiteout, with its careening songs like Cuff Dam, Tart Tart, and Cob 20. But there was a sonic chaos, too, that was intriguing. There was a lot going on here. Ryder says, "That first album, to me, I was learning on the job. And by Bummed, the band's next album in 1988, I was a bit better. And by Pills and Thrills and Bellyaches, 1990, I knew what I was doing." The band's ascent quickly became the stuff of fable, and subsequently folklore. The Mondays' earlier underworld leanings didn't recede as their fame grew, but simply became a deeper part of their shtick. The chaos perpetuated and clung to them. They became a spectator sport. You'd look and wonder, what next? What now? By 1990, Manchester was the epicenter of all that was exciting in music, and due to its reliance upon drugs, particularly ecstasy, was duly anointed Madchester for its decadence, its daring, its sheer rapacious appetite. While the Stone Roses headlined, the Happy Mondays were the after-show party, their music thrilling and splenetic, a magnificent racket whose ramshackleness belied.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.